Hello everyone, welcome to my stream. Happy Friday everyone. Welcome on my stream. I'm George. You can find me as Walker on various different Amiga forums. It's Friday, one more stream about AmigaOS. We have AmigaOS 4 here to have a look, and today we are going to do the second part of the previous stream. We are going to talk about the AmigaOS 4.1 and the development environment that we created the previous week on the last stream. And we are going to continue looking on different tools that are necessary and useful to build your own applications to run on AmigaOS 4.1. Sorry for the delayed start of the streaming, but I had some issues with OBS which crashed a couple of times. Actually, when I started the streaming, it crashed, and then I had to reboot, because if it crashes, it doesn't close totally and it keeps some resources. So yeah, I had to do that. I have to figure out why this is happening. Possibly one of the plugins that I'm using make it crash, and I have disabled right now to see if that's the reason. If you remember from last Friday, I had an issue when I switched to my supporter's view, and the OBS crashed, and at some point you lost me completely. Without further ado, let's proceed and have a look on today's topic, which is of course development on AmigaOS 4.1. And the last things that we saw on last Friday was a few editors that are available for you to use. Always I mention to you editors that are available for AmigaOS 4, but I mention also tools and applications that exist on AmigaOS 3 for 68K CPUs, so that you can apply what you see here on your AmigaOS 3 system if you would like to do it. So as well, today we are going to continue with the editors and some other tools that have to do with the document files that come with the SDK, about the SDK and the contents of the SDK package. We discussed it on the previous stream, so if you missed it, have a look on that. It is available for a few more days on Twitch, but also it's available on my YouTube channel. So let's see some more editors. I would like to show you the Annotate. Annotate is one editor that is available for AmigaOS 68K CPUs as well. For the version that is coming for AmigaOS 4, it is a native one. It is built for the PPC, and it has the interface is based on Magic User Interface, but it has also a reaction version. We have seen before the Annotate in this stream, but not in full depth, which I'm going to try to do it now. Not actually full depth, because each editor has so many options for you to play with, but the basic some specific features that I like on this editor. And for example, if you would like to have multiple files, how this is used in Annotate. First of all, the version is 3.0.1. I know that a newer version is currently in development. This version for OS 4 is developed by Daniel Westerberg, and it's free to download. And actually, inside the archive that you get with the Annotate, you also get its code. So there is a folder called Annotate Source, and there you can find the whole source of this editor, which you can use to extend it if you want, or fix issues and send them back to the actual developer. So what I like first of all for about Annotate is that it has a basic way that it works quite well to keep your projects. You have different applications that you develop, and each application has multiple files, so you open the files and then you have to remember which files you opened last time, and all this stuff can be automated by going to projects, and let's say you have an already created project, which we will see how you can do it. And I have, for example, here the Annotate project, which has some of the files that is available about this editor. It has color syntaxing for different programming languages. Here it is about C. You have all the code in here. And then if you have different files, you can load them at the sidebar here. And you can have the hidden editors, which means hidden windows with the specific file opened, and the one that you actually see right now. For example, if I want to switch to another file, I just click on that and really fast switches the file, and now I can see the other file. If I want to have multiple files on the same time open, then I will be able to select one and show it. Let me see. No, I can do that and then select one and show it. You have to disable the single click to swap. So right now, if I resize the window, I have the second file here, and actually I can move it to the right side. If this is quite helpful if you want to have a list on the right side and another list on the middle and see things on both of these files. And then continue on doing some coding, of course. That's why we use the editors. For example, void, this is a new method, let's say. And then, as you can see, it is quite fast. The color syntaxing is happening while you are typing. And even for big files, the scrolling speed is really, really fast on this editor without increasing the CPU usage on your system. As I said, this editor is available for 68K CPUs as well, and it is available for Morphos as well, and it has a lot of ways to change how it behaves, how it works. It has a lot of menu items to make it work, to use different features, but also if you go to configuration, you can change if you want this to open in a different screen, or you want it to be on the workbench, or many different things that you can change based on how you want to make it work for you. This is quite convenient if you are used to use different editors in different operating systems, and you would like to keep on having some specific shortcuts that are convenient for you to be able on the editor to change things like that. Also, you can see here that you can change the whole menu, all the menus and the shortcuts, or even add your own menu items here that can be used to to automate a little bit your work. You can record macros for things that you are doing all the time, and then later to replicate them by key shortcuts and etc. The Annotate is quite powerful, and I totally recommend you to try this out. It has some way to edit the color syntax based on the type of the file, and also create your own color syntax based on languages that are not currently supported. There is actually a folder here that says syntax contribution, and here there is information on how to create your color syntaxing and what you can do with them. If we open one of them, you see that it is a plain XML file, and based on that you can make it work like you would like for specific programming languages. For example, by default Python is not supported. If you write code for Python, you might want to create your own color syntaxing and then set that specific keywords are going to use a specific style like bold and then the pen 3. And if I'm not wrong, let me see here, there is a whole section with all the colors. Yeah, here, XML. No. Yeah. Yeah, from this here you can see all the pen numbers, and then when you change them you can see it at the back, so you can find exactly what you would like to use. For example, if I go to text and I change the, you see exactly what is happening at the back, which is really convenient if you want to make things like that and create your own syntaxing. As you see, there are a couple of there are a lot of languages supported, and absolutely recommended for you to try this out. Yeah, one of the features that I love is the way that the projects are saved and how you can manipulate multiple files in this editor, how you can switch, and also the speed of the scrolling. Welcome SLD Snake, welcome Falcon 11, Livelord, welcome to the stream, thank you for being here. SLD Snake says hello there, leaving the stream in the background, I'll take a look in the wild. Thank you SLD Snake, happy to have you here. Welcome everyone. So if you want an editor that is quite fast, it is available for AmigaOS 3 as well, although I believe that in AmigaOS 3 the version of Annotate is not maintained anymore, but it is there, and if you want to have a similar experience you can find it there as well. If you want an editor that is free of charge and it is quite fast and it has all the features that you might need to develop, I certainly propose to try the Annotate. I find it a little bit having a few bugs here and there, especially on closing some documents, like now you see that it something crashed, but as I said, the OS 4 version is still maintained. The developer, as I know, he's working on an update that I hope that he is going to release soon. And yeah, it's something that even that the code is there, it is useful for you to go and see how things are working and maybe fix some of these bugs. Another editor that I would like to show you is Vim. It's quite popular on other operating systems, especially on Unix systems. We have a version of Vim here. It is quite new. Let me show you here. It is 8.2.2993 of Vim. You can open your code here. Let me open something. Let's say from MediaVault code. I will open this file. You can have also you can have multiple tabs, open tab, and then put here the other file and switch between them. Although the strength of Vim is not to use it by mouse. It has a lot shortcuts, so its power is mostly to use it with those shortcuts. Although it is a little bit difficult to remember, for me at least. So if you use Vim in other operating systems and you would like to use it on AmigaOS 4, it is available. For example, here right now, I can't write. Just now I just hit a couple of shortcuts and I deleted this line. OP81, welcome to the stream. Thank you for being here. So it has to, yeah. Vim is a little bit weird if you don't know how to use it. It's not so user friendly, right? So for example, if you want to insert something here, you have first to click on Escape and then I, because Escape starts says to Vim that I want to execute something, and I, it says to Vim that it is I want to insert in the document. So now I can go and write something. If I want to delete this line, I have to press Escape, 2 times D, and it deletes this line. And then Escape again to start typing. Escape I and start typing. And if you want to save it, you can do it by Escape, colon, and as you can see at the bottom, I can write something there. And by clicking W and enter, I saved that document and those changes. And if I want again to go and insert something, I have again to click on Escape, I, enter, and so on. Falcon 11 says Vim has two modes. What's the second? That's the you mean about the environment? Because here it opens in a Magic User Interface window with menus at the top, for example, and one inside the terminal, which I'm going to show exactly after that, this mode here. OP81 says, how are you doing? I'm fine, thank you very much. Sorry for missing your stream, but it have been a lot of at work. Don't worry at all, OP, don't worry at all. I'm glad you are here. You can always catch up with the previous streams if you would like at my YouTube channel, where I upload everything there. The other thing, if you want to find something here, you can have to click Escape, slash, and then type what you want to find. For example, render hook. And this is going to mark everything for based on what you are looking for. And then Escape, slash again, enter, and search, slash again, enter, and things like that. Yeah, there are a lot of people who are passionate about the Vim. The good thing with this, yes, OP, this is 4.1. AmigaOS 4.1, the latest version. The good thing with Vim is that it supports so many file types for programming. For example, you can see here all this list are different languages that are supported, especially on the way that it does the color syntaxing. Okay, and it also has a few color schemes if you want to change how it looks like based on what is your preference of colors. So if I want right now to save this document and quit, I have to do escape colon WQ, and that's the shortcuts that I remember. Falcon 11 says two modes, I mean write mode and the first mode that you break with escape. Yes. Yeah, the when you press escape is something like telling to the program what exactly you want to do. If you go, if you open a shell at a terminal and you write vim, vi, right now you are still in this inside the terminal and you can open your files here or write your code here and then save it, or if you don't want, quit without saving anything. So this editor is quite useful if you are using it in servers, because you don't have a user interface there, but that's why a lot of people are using Vim. It is really fast, really, really fast. And if you get familiar with all the shortcuts and all the commands that Vim is using, it's really efficient to use it to write code. There are plenty of plugins that you can add to have, for example, a file listed at the left side and open the files from there, or navigate through the through your file system to find the files that you want to use, or open projects and start developing. I will not fool you. I'm not familiar with all this stuff. I prefer something more user-friendly. Okay, so but I use Vim totally in my servers, and that's why I know just the basic shortcuts. Falcon 11 says I use it on servers on Linux machines, testers for cars in my work. Yeah, it's perfect because it is quite small and it does the job quite well. OP says I installed 3.2.1 last weekend. How is your experience about that? Did you have any issues with the update? We did a stream a few weeks ago about the update, and it was pretty good. I like the fixes a lot. So, and that's Vim as well, because if you have it inside your terminal, you can go, for example, in C/S, okay, and say, yeah, if I write it right, and say that vi user startup, and you have it here. It's that fast, and if you would like to say that, okay, I want to comment that out, insert, and then write what you want and save it and exit. I will not do that for now. Escape, W to write, Q to exit, and that's it. That's why it is quite fast for something, for me, for something simple. Others are, I have been present in fights about which editor is the best, but as I said on my previous stream, this topic is so subjective, because every developer wants something different from the editors. So people are quite passionate for Vim, and that's it. We have a quite new version of Vim in AmigaOS 4 if you want to use it. Another editor that I wanted to show you is the MaxonDev Pro 68K, quite old editor, right? If you see here, it is, let me show you the about. This version is from 1996, a lot of years ago. Falcon 11 says, I also 3.2.1 on my Blizzard PPC and BVision system, all was and is okay. That's great, Falcon. Uli says, welcome to the stream. Apologies if you have said this already, but what hardware do you run OS 4 on? Currently, the system that I'm running this stream is an X5000 with 4 cores. Of course, the cores is not are not used. Just one core of them is used, but that will come at some point, I guess. I also tested the OS 4 on my quite old machine, which is a micro Amiga one that I bought back in 2005, which is still working, although this kind of computers were a little bit fragile. And also I have beside me an A1222 Tabor computer, with some beta testing as well. OP says it crashed and couldn't read the MetaID port on my Terriblefire 1260 card. I have custom ROMs to use it, but it works on the Amiga ID port. That's weird. Maybe this is a problem with the drivers of the ID port of the Terriblefire. Maybe, maybe not. I'm not aware. Sorry. Falcon 11 says, I think that's also on one core, it's enough. If you have the hardware, it's never enough. You always want something more. If you have something there, you want this to be utilized, right? But yeah, for most things, it is enough. If, think about it, if you had multiple cores, okay, and you have the browser opening a page, and one core executes the JavaScript and the other core executes the rendering of the page and things like that, I believe that things are going to become faster. Ulysses says, I was wondering about the A1222, might be my entry intro OS 4. It is quite well hardware. I have one of the first ones that was provided for beta testing a few years ago. It is quite powerful, especially for things that have to do with the graphics card. For example, watching a movie there. If you have a Radeon RX graphics card, this can play even 4K video on this machine. It has two cores. In general, it seems like faster than a SAM 460, because it has faster memory, it has a faster bus, but the SAM 460 is more time in the market, so things that didn't go well were fixed so far. Falcon 11 wants more. Me too, Falcon 11. I want more as well. And also, he says, and will be in near future support for more cores AmigaOS 4. This is something that the ExecSG team is working for some time now. If you watch their announcements on AmiWest last year, they mentioned that, and they are working on that. It remains to be seen and be finished. OP says that I have the new alpha firmware in my Terriblefire 1260, so it can be that it have a small bug. Yeah, probably. When you say alpha firmware, I guess it is not well tested, right? Yeah, probably is that. So the this Maxon developer, it is a 68K application, of course. It is not native for AmigaOS 4, but it runs quite well. Let me open here a few files to see you to show you how it works. Let's go to the parent and get the annotate source here, and get a big file, which is, let's see, this one. Unfortunately, one of the things that I don't like here for this editor is that I can't use my scroll wheel on the mouse. So it's difficult to scroll because you have to go to the bar and scroll here, but as you can see, it's quite fast. It has color syntaxing, a basic color syntaxing on the editor. It's meant to use it to create code for 68K CPUs. That's why if you go to settings and the compiler, you can see that it has a specific configuration that you can do about the compiler and the specific for the processors that are supported. There is a compiler that comes with this development environment as well. You can change things about the assembler and the linker. There are a lot of things. If you want to develop for 68K, this environment, this MaxonDev environment, is quite useful. It has debugger, it has a way to see, to monitor the memory on specific times, or even the check the system info. For example, here you see the libraries that are running and the versions and where exactly and devices. This is quite useful. I am sure that if you are doing development for AmigaOS 3, they are quite useful, especially that you can set specific breakpoints where you can check on specific lines of your code. When you execute your code, it stops there and you can check the values on the variables, and you can find bugs quite easier. Unfortunately, these things are not useful for AmigaOS 4 development, but if you want to use this editor as just an editor to develop applications for OS 4 and then go to your GCC and make the compile, this is possible. OP says it's this, but still have some bugs. For example, I can clock it to 100 megahertz, but it will crash. Yeah, I guess it depends on the CPU that you have, if it supports the 100 megahertz, right? It's just stable in 94 megahertz. It's quite fast, OP. Hello, Aris Amiga, welcome to the stream. Livelo says, I wish someone come up with accelerator for Amiga 4000, something like Buffy. I guess it's coming. We will see. OP, the 94 stable megahertz is quite fast, right? You don't earn anything with 6 more megahertz. I would go with the 90 just to keep it a little less warm and more stable. JMA, welcome to the stream. Glad you all be here. As you can see, the colors of the text are a little bit off. And that's because of the configuration of the pens on the workbench. So if you go to user interface, there is a way to change the font that you are using, and also open the, where is it, screen here. You can go to own screen, and now you see that the colors are much better here. If you open multiple files, for example this one as well, I open the same, this one, okay, which is quite big, and the scroll is really, really fast. You can switch the open files from here, which is also quite useful. You have the search, of course, you have copy, paste, and cut, save the files, and also there is a way to manipulate, to manage your projects from this window here, where you can give, for example, add many files at the side. Let me go here. It asks you for some of the files that doesn't know what they are, how manipulate them. Let me skip them. And you have all the files here. So right now I have a project that I can open the different files. I can proceed to compile if I configure the compiler to use this editor and these files. And yeah, there are a lot of things that this development environment has, and is well made, and it works quite well under OS 4. So if you are using this environment on your OS 3 system and you would like to do stuff on your OS 4 system, this is working just fine, and you have a similar environment to work on. And as I said, yeah, it is the latest version that I found. Have in mind that if you find it by default, it lacks the translation files, the catalog files for English. So you need to track them down and install them later, and make it have this language on the menus and the user interface. Otherwise, it is completely in German, which I don't understand. So I'm glad I found the catalog somewhere else. Actually, the catalog, you can go and install it on your system partition, or you can create a catalogs folder here with the English and add the file there, which is also working just fine. So those are the last of the editors that I would like to show you. We have some time ago more to have a look on three other tools that I like to use. If you remember, on the inside the SDK there is a lot of documentation. Under the folder documentation you have a lot of files, and there are the AutoDocs. This kind of files are basic text files, basically, like that. You can open them in multi-view or wherever you want, and you can read them. But as you can see, they have a specific format, which means that there are ways to open them and use them more simple, or a better way to find things in them, instead of scrolling a huge file. Falcon 11 says, you have a lot of editors to show, really. Yeah, because I'm trying a lot of things to find the best editor for me, which I found. And I will show you again. I showed you the Lite XL the previous week, but I have extra news for you today about this editor. So there are three tools that I'm using: the AutoDoc Reader, the SDK Browser, and the AutoDoc Viewer. Actually, the AutoDoc Viewer comes; it is available on inside the. Where is it? Not this. Inside the SDK, you can find it also in local C here. But this one is an older version, as you can see. And the newer one is available on OS 40 pod. So all these files are free of charge. You can download and see which one is better for you. So, and these applications are available also, not all three of them. I think only the AutoDoc Reader is available for 68K, which is this one. It is based on Magic User Interface. It it sees the SDK AutoDocs here and lists all the files here, which, for example, you can go and select if you want to do something for the DOS, for file system, and things like that. You can go and select the DOS. It is here. And as soon as you select it, it parses the file, the text file that we saw earlier. It puts all the methods that you can use at the left side in this list here. And you can go and see, select something, for example, the match next. You get that the information here in a better way to read them. And at the top, you see all the how you can call this method with which parameters and things like that. And it's quite useful. Also, you can go to other methods by double-clicking if you see them in blue color, like a link. It helps you to go and find other similar things that you might need. For example, the match end. Double-click, and it leads you there. This is something that all three programs are doing. You can go and see, you can go here and change the path or open another file from somewhere else. Have in mind that the AutoDoc structure is used by most of the operating of the document files that we are using for development. So it's quite useful to get familiar with that. You can also go here and say that I'm looking for something. For example, a method that is called strlcat. If you click enter, it leads you to utility document file, and there is this method, the one that I'm looking for. And at the side, I see the name, the synopsis, and what does that do? A small description of what it does and how I can use it. And then there is also an example here to see how an example of how it is used. And at the bottom, it has also a search inside the document to find other things. Quite useful is the navigator at the top, where you can use the back and forward to move to the previous file that you were watching, you were reading, or the next one, like that. And from the button at the middle, you see a list of all the files that you temporarily opened, and navigate to them. If you were looking on something, then it is quite fast to go go back to that again. As I said, the AutoDoc Reader is available for 68K and for Morphos, but it has some small issues on the parsing of the documents, which can be seen in some methods, like you see part of the example inside this area and not in the example area. This is not a big deal, but have that in mind. The other document reader that I'm using is the AutoDoc Viewer. It's quite simple. It's based on reaction. It has also the same features like the previous one. For example, if I go to DOS, I can see at the top all the methods that are available and click on something and see here all the information. This one doesn't split the example to a different tab or something. It has search here. For example, I can search for the same method and find it in the utility library and click on that and go there and see exactly what this method does and how I can use it. AutoDocReader is perfect, says Falcon 11. Too much text for read, yes. Especially on documents like the DOS document, which is huge, and the utility document, which is huge as well, they are quite useful. And also to have a way to search in all these documents. As you can see, here I have a list of the Magic User Interface documents as well. Okay, and some of the other of the tools for localize, for example, and things like that. It is quite useful to have a way to search on all of them at once. If you go to the preferences, you can add folders in your hard disks where you keep all the documents, so you can add them there, and then whenever you open the program, all these files are listed. Dat and Hobel, welcome to the stream. Thank you for being here. You can change the way the font that it uses, or go to a different screen if you want. ADT, yeah. Yeah. About bugs, I don't have anything to report. Glad you are here. So yeah, and also it has a way to go back to the previous document and then navigate between the ones that you already opened. ADV, yeah, of course. This viewer for me, Dat and Hobel, is my preferred one because it is quite fast. It opens really, really fast. It is fast when you click on document, and then you don't waste time to wait for things. And yeah, it works quite well for me. And also, if you go to, for example, let me show you STRL cut. Okay, I'm looking for that again. And click here. And if I go at the bottom, there is this section that says see also, right? So these are also like links. If you double click on them, you can go to the other method. Again, double click, go to the other method. So you have a navigation inside the text, which is very, very nice. Very nice. And then if you have that open, you can minimize it. Have it. Here it is a bug. Dat and Hobel. No, no, it is not showing the right icon. There's a bug. Not crucial, of course, but it's something that will be nice to have. Yeah, the AutoDoc Viewer is my preferred one, and I recommend it a lot. OP says you can send it to the builder, he can help you. He's talking about the terrible fire. Okay. And the last one that I recommend for OS 4, but it is quite heavier than the others we had a look on, is the SDK browser. It has a lot of features which might be useful for some, for some others not. Let me fire up the X5000 right now. I'm in the mood of fixing something, says Daten Hobel. Tell us also which editors and which tools you like to use, especially the editors, because we have seen a lot of them in today's stream and the previous one. And yeah, it is nice to listen from developers what they like to use. So the SDK browser is free of charge. You can download it. I believe it is available on Aminate. You can have it here, different lists of things that you, from the documentation. It parses the documentation, all the document files, and it gives you different ways to find the information that you need. For example, you have a list of all the commands from all the document files, so you see it is a huge list. You can have the AutoDoc, so here we can find the DOS. For example, go here, and we have all the methods in the middle. And then click on something, and it leads you to the this part of the document where you can find information. And if there are other methods at the bottom, you can click and go. Actually, you can click on every part of the code, like here, and you can be transferred to that document. Daten Hobel says, I'm old school and still with Gold Editor Cubic IDE. Yep, yeah, I have them here. Cubic IDE, it's very nice and I use it all the time. And SDK browser, what else? You can search down here. There are ways to, different ways to search into the documentation that you have and also in the SDK. For example, if I search something inside the let me move it at the top so you can see it better. Search entire SDK, the entire folder of the SDK, which sometimes is quite useful because you want to find something in either in examples or in the include files. So you put something here, for example, what can I, let's say strlcat, press enter, and starts to search in the entire SDK. You can stop it, of course, and go to the part of the code or the file that you would like to see. For example, here it says block size .c, so you have already here an example from the SDK that uses that method, and check how it is used. You can go, of course, with opening the other way that you can do it, go to the SDK like that, click write AmigaOS to open the find, and search like that here. That's a way to do it if you want. Another way to do it inside the SDK browser. It has search inside includes only, of course. A lot of different ways to search, which is quite powerful if you want to find fast something that is necessary for you, right? And also at the top, it has a way to see all the previously opened files and navigate to the previous and to the next one if you want. It also has a file browser. One of the things that I don't like about this program is that whenever you change to something else, it always tries to show you something. So here it tries to show me the PDF file, the first file at the top of the list tries to open it, which is a little bit weird to have it. and work like that. For example, binaries, tries to open binaries. It doesn't make sense for me. But yeah, it is there. You can find all the information in a very good way, and it is available for free if you would like to test it. So all these files, all these programs are doing the same thing. You just have to decide which one is better for you and use it. There are other AutoDoc viewers also for 68K CPUs and computers on Aminet. Other are powerful, other are just basic, and you can select from them what you would like to use on your 060 CPU and have the best of the experience. Okay. And the last part that I would like to show you today is the project that I'm currently working. It is an editor, and sorry, Datenhobel, about that, but it is not the old school editor. It is quite new, quite modern. That's Lite XL. I showed you about that on the previous stream, the previous version that I was working. And actually, a few days ago, I released the last version about this editor. But now I'm working on the last code that is available for this editor. This editor is developed by a group of people, of developers for Linux, macOS, and Windows. And I'm working on porting that to Amiga. This is version 2.0.4. Let me change the color scheme. It has a lot of issues yet, especially on things like notification from the file system when a file changes and to reload and things like that. But it works quite well so far. Welcome, Amiga Gamer. Welcome to the stream. Thank you for being here. Thank you, everyone, for being here. So I would like to show you the newest things about this editor and see if it is something that you would like to use. I want to make it work quite well before I release something, but it is there. One of the things that it has, for example, let me open a couple of files. These ones, okay. You can drag a tab to another place and open that like that and split the area like this. If you have a dark color, it shows exactly where it goes. So it is quite fast to move them to other places. Or even say that I want this file to see it twice, side by side. Let me make it a little bit full screen and do something like split right. So I have the same file at the other side here. If you want to have something at the top to look at and write something at the bottom of the file, this is possible to be done. And also say that I want to open this file as well at this side or at the bottom, or even say that I want here to have a big lock so that I won't waste too much time. You can have it like that and continue working, which is nice. One of the features that for me it's very crucial, and if you are watching my streams, I'm sure you understood so far, is having big files and have Actually, I don't like at all to have big files, but if I have a big file, I want this to be able to scroll quite fast. Against the previous version, the scrolling speed is much faster, and not because it is on an X5000 right now. I tested that application on my micro Amiga One, and it was actually quite fast. And I would like to remind you here that we are talking about text that is fully idealized, with a lot of plugins here to show, for example, these lines here are added by plugins to show the depth of the tabs, or to have different colors on the curly brackets or the brackets, so to understand where it opens and closes. It's there. The other quite useful that a few of you requested on the previous version of Lite XL is to have multiple cursors. So if you are here and you click Shift and the cursor down, you select something. But if you click, where is it? No. Sorry, I ruined everything. Okay. Yeah, if you click Shift and Control, you create multiple cursors, and you can write something on multiple places. If you don't want to do it, you also have the option to select something, and this is all the similar words are marked. But if you click Control and D, you create multiple cursors on all these places. So you can find, for example, the name of a specific variable, and you want to change something, add an underscore and say, new var. Name underscore name, you can do it like that, which is quite useful if you want to change things like that. Some people might prefer to go to select and replace everything. Okay, that's also a good way to do it. But if you wanted to go on every, for example, objects like that, and say I want to go to the last or go to something here and make a change, this is not possible to do it. There are situations that it's more useful to do it like that, to have multiple cursors. So this is there, and it is working quite well. Falcon Level says nice features. The marker are also nice feature. Yeah. There are a lot of things that it has that we miss from the editors that we have in our in AmigaOS 4 and AmigaOS 3. As I said, the scroll speed is quite faster than the previous. There are a few problems which I'm trying to fix. I would like to remind you that this editor is based on SDL and Lua. The Lua code that is included, let me show you, change project, and let me go to the editor. The Lua code is plain text files. Okay, so someone who knows how to program in this language, he can change the way that the editor actually works. Thank you for being here, Opie. Have a great weekend. Thank you. So you can experiment if you want how some things are working on the editor and change the way that from the Lua scripts. And that's quite fast. This editor is still on development, of course. And the good thing is that it is developed for other operating systems, so it has a good support. And I think that when I saw the difference on the speed, and that I was able to use it on my micro Amiga One quite well, I was surprised. So yeah, I wanted to share that with you. And it has a lot of other features as well, which I hope that soon I'm going to be able to make a release and see you what you think about it. If you have this night mode of the editor, you can open different files, for example here, and then when you drag them, as you can see, it has a way to show you where exactly it's going to go. Like that. And if you have this markdown, there is also the plugin that you can do something like preview that, select the browser that you want. Odyssey is preferred for this kind of things, and then opens that in Odyssey in a second and show you the preview of the this file. Let me reboot it, reload it. Okay. And here you have the preview of the changes that you are doing in the editor. For example, test here, save. Preview, and you see here the changes. Falcon 11 says I will try on Amiga PPC Classic. Yep, it will be it will be quite a test. I would like to see how it works there, Falcon. I would like to see, of course, for low end machines. And I'm not saying that the Classic is a low-end, not at all. For low-end machines, it is preferred to use the rest of the editors that we have available. For example, the Cubic IDE that I showed you earlier on the previous stream, or the Cygnus editor. Actually, I would like to show you that's one thing that it makes sense to see. Let me open the init Lua here, and before we see that, to see a little bit the differences on scrolling speed, if you allow me. Let me refresh. Okay, I will open the core Lua init Lua here, and I will open the same file on Cubic IDE. This is here, data core on Cygnus editor and Cubic IDE. Okay, for the Cubic IDE, it doesn't have color syntaxing because it doesn't understand Lua. But it doesn't matter for now. So this code is 1,384 lines. Okay. At the top here, at the top, you can see maybe, I hope so. Let me go to the full computer to help you on that. You can see the CPU usage. Let me make it also here. Okay, you will see that when we scroll up and down with Cygnus editor, how much CPU usage we have on an X5000. Falcon 11 says low end, but no in prices. Yeah, you're right. That's the Cygnus editor on scrolling this, and you have seen that the scrolling is not so smooth, so it passes blocks of the code. Let's see the cubic ID. Cubic ID uses less CPU than the Cygnus editor. Okay. And the code is 1,385 lines. It's not that tremendously big. And let's see the same file on here on Lite XL. The difference on the CPU usage is quite big, right? And that's logical because it is an SDL application. It is not optimized for this computer. Actually, it reaches 100% all the time. And that's logically. The good thing is that as soon as you stop, it falls down to the 2% or 5%. And by my tests, when you code, you don't do all this stuff back and forward all the time, right? By my tests, it is not blocking other applications. I like to listen to online radio stations when I code, or listen to podcasts. So I had very big problems when I was using CodeBench and tried to scroll a little bit on my on the code, because the scroller, the editor blocks a lot other processes for some reason. I never experienced that with this editor. So if you want to have an editor that works exactly the same way on other systems, and you want to have a more modern editor, and if you have a good computer, like better than the micro Amiga one, so any Amiga one computer, so I believe that you will not have issues to use Lite XL. Otherwise, I recommend Cubic ID first, CodeBench second, and third, the Cygnus editor for me. And yep, that's what I would like to show you today. I hope that I will be able to solve a few issues with Lite XL version 2 quite soon, and make a new release soon for you to try that out and have your own opinion on what is best for you, and yeah, be able to code awesome things for our systems, right? Because that's the point. Falcon 11 says SDL is good for saving programs, but yeah, not optimized and need too much sources. I am not sure about if it is really optimized for our system or not, because I was not able to view the code of it, or I'm not that experienced to say if it is optimized or not, but I have seen very nice games running quite well on AmigaOS 4 based on SDL, right? So I believe that is quite well done. But I'm not sure if it is the perfect solution for us on applications. On the other side, if I will be able to find a word processor, for example, developed on SDL and was possible to be ported to AmigaOS 4, I will try to do it. Because it is better to have something that works well, even if it has it gets some CPU usage, than something else, which is modern and gives you all the best features of the editors out there, than having nothing, right? In my opinion. And yeah, things like that shows how better this operating system is against a plain AmigaOS 3 system, which is not able to run things like that. Of course, if you are a developer, even on ED, the basic editor that comes with any AmigaOS system, you can do tremendous things. Even on Emacs that was available on AmigaOS 3, but now changed with TextEdit, you can do tremendous things. But sometimes it is better to have tools that don't get you in your way when you try to do things, right? That's my opinion. If those tools can make your life easier because they give you the features that you need, it is better to have them. Especially for an editor that if you write code on other systems and you are getting used to the way that the other systems are working, you would like to have that on AmigaOS 4 as well. And that, in my opinion, gives you a feeling that things are moving forward, right? For example, if you have an editor color syntaxing, that's something that seems, for me, it's quite useful. I love having color syntaxing. Of course, we saw earlier that the DevCon, did I say that right? The MaxonDev, the MaxonDev Pro from 1996 had color syntaxing. The Cubic ID has color syntaxing. So if that's the features that you need, they are there. You can use them, right? I just wish that Cubic ID, the developer of Cubic ID, returns and maintains this application and makes it better and added extra features. And I would like also to see the Cygnus editor some extra love from the developers or the producers. So for today, that's my stream that I would like to share with you. Maybe on the next stream, I will try to cover some other languages that are available and you can use. Daten Hobel says, don't think so. Dietmar Ehlert must be quite old by today. Yeah, I spoke with him a few times, and unfortunately he's not willing to develop more the Cubic ID, which is one of the best applications that I have seen in any operating system, because it has so many ways to change the way that it works, which, as I said on my previous stream, sometimes seems so chaotic. But yeah, it's powerful. I created a couple of modules for that, and yeah, I saw the power that it has. Daten Hobel says, I thought so. Dietmar always was a bit special, but Cubic is also a monster. It is a monster. It is a monster, and it's great the way that it works on OS 4, how stable it is. But for example, you are not able to show the white space characters. If you have a space or a tab, this is not possible to be done in Cubic ID. At least I didn't find a way, and when I spoke with Dietmar, he said that it is not possible. So this is something that you need, especially I needed that because I was writing code for Python, and you know, Python complains for indentation, so I wanted to see what exactly I have there. And I ended up to use a Cygnus editor for my Python scripts, because it shows you exactly this kind of characters. Anyway, the editor is subjective matter. Everyone has to find their beloved editor and use it to make awesome stuff for our systems. And for that, I would like to thank all my supporters, and especially Daniel Trixi, Jenlika, T. Livelord, and Roman Kagin, who support me from the Ko-fi page that I have, and all my supporters who give me the opportunity to create open source applications and provide the source for anyone to see how I am doing stuff, and maybe inspire them or help them understand a few things on how to do stuff on AmigaOS 4 and AmigaOS 3. And also I would like to mention that every month, at the end of every month, 50% of my donations are going to other developers in the Amiga scene. And by that I mean that if someone supports me, then automatically supports other awesome projects, and yeah, I'm going to continue to do it for as long as I create stuff for AmigaOS 4, AmigaOS 3, and maybe in the future I will create something for Morphos as well. I would like to thank you all for being here, watching my stream, joining me here on this topic. As I said, next week I'm planning to visit other languages and show you some stuff about that, programming languages, and we will see. If you have any ideas on what you would like to see in my streams, please don't hesitate to contact me. And yeah, have a great weekend, everyone. Take care, have some rest, and see you soon. Thank you for being here. Bye-bye.